Of course, I'm not going to say what I'm planning to say, everything I'm planning to say, but anyway, I'm very happy to organize a system. You've given me so much time to say what I wanted to say. In a way, today's lecture might be sort of independent, although we are going to recover results which I announced in the previous lecture, but in a way, it is independent, and this is about duality. Are two sorts, by Schur-Weyl duality or how duality, but in special superstating, plus we are going to include now infinity. So we are going to go to infinity. But let me start with a very classical thing, which is called Schur-Weyl duality. And here I should put the name of Sergei because he did it in supercase. Now I'm going to formulate this result. So let us consider G element. M and V in a general configuration. And when I consider a tensor form of V with itself, P times T, okay, and when I want to decompose it with respect to Gell-Lyman action. So we know that in general, the representation of Gell-Lyman are not completely reducible. We have seen it. But at least they still are. And the main idea is that on this thing, the symmetric group on P letters also F. So the action is straightforward, only you shouldn't forget the sign rule. So if I take the first one as P minus 1 on adjacent transpositions, when the action of xi switches to go in the middle here, and the only difference is that it now switches to the sign. And then, of course, this action computes with the action of Gell-Lyman. Okay? And the theorem says that, in fact, if I consider the map of the group algebra of the symmetric group given by this action to n domains, this action is easily immediately see commutes with the action of Gell-Lyman. So it is actually in endomorphisms of Gell-Lyman of P times of P. And the point is that this map is always surjective. Diagram with p boxes plus additional condition which I'm going to explain. And then I have S and L. And what is there, I take a Schur projector and apply it in the vertex lambda V. Tensor, I would say Y lambda, where Y lambda is the corresponding reducible representation of this, corresponding to in the standard way. Okay? Now, of course, there is this condition, additional condition of lambda. So if n equals 0, when s lambda of v is not 0, if...
yes. Something I didn't quite... So you're saying that it implies that v to b is semi-simple for g element?
Yes.
Just because it's centralizer is semi-simple? Mm-hmm. I mean, you could take a...
No, it's double centralizer. Yeah.
Oh, because... You have a double... Yeah, but do you have the double...
Yes, I think I didn't say this, right?
Yeah, so you need to say then that the centralizer, if you take it again, then it is, then you get the enveloping algebra of G-element there.
Right, double centralizer property. Yes. Sorry, you are absolutely right. I do have double centralizer property here, and you are right, so... I should say that the centralizer, so endomorphism, right, thank you very much, I forgot to say it. It's generated by U of G, or equal to, yes, it's generated. By G of M. So it's coincides with the image of the universal analog in algebra. Right, thanks, I forgot to mention it. So if n equals 0, then s lambda of v is not 0, if you all know if lambda has no, has at most L rows. Now you can easily guess what happens if L is 0. So what I'm going to have in this case is representation of L0L, right? So what is the condition? May I ask?
The cos.
Of course, yes. Cos, right? Because what is this thing does, and what means that I'm working over what space, symmetric cos becomes...
How the sign.
Exactly. It becomes exterior and vice versa.
But lambda is a partition of phi.
Lambda is a partition of phi, which is written here.
But what does it mean, plus question mark?
That's exactly it. I want to write down an additional condition, and I'm basically now saying what is this additional condition, if m equals 0 and n equals 0.
So it's not a number to add to p.
No.
It's not p plus some.
Oh, no, it's just additional condition, sorry. Maybe I should put
m.
No, you don't need to put y weight is 0, right?
Why could it be zero? No. Oh, yeah. It's an irreducible representation of this. Okay. So, and in general, it's a very beautiful condition. In general, it's called MM hook condition.
But this is due to Borel-Weil-Bott, really, right?
No, it's actually due to Sigmund. In his PhD thesis, before. I mean, Borel-Weil-Bott did it independently, which you can write it down, but in fact, I can write down Borel-Weil-Bott and Wigert because they really wrote a nice exposition. I may be a picture of Borel-Weil-Bott and Wigert. And so what is this M hook? Now, you take an infinite hook. So here I can. Yeah. Yeah. And my lambda should fit into this hook. So I should be like this. Right? But this box is for people. Actually, it is an easy, not difficult exercise, check this condition. So what you have to check, that you pick up a basis vector in terms of product, and you apply to it a Young symmetrizer, and when it is not zero.
You said S lambda is non-zero if the diagram has this kind of shape.
If it could be fit into this hook.
But the X is, has to be there.
No, it's forbidden.
No, it's forbidden guy.
Ah, that's forbidden.
Forbidden guy. Forbidden box.
It's equivalent to the hook condition that is forbidden.
And then, of course, my D1 is mu orthogonal 1, and mu DL, so DI is mu orthogonal I. You see? So,
and don't allow negative.
Exactly, there is no negative here. And why this is so? Because what we are talking about are polynomial representations. Okay? So actually, that allows even to write down character formula. This is somewhat different character formula. The character of S lambda of V. So there is a formula for the Schur polynomial, which involves determinant. And exactly the same formula works here. So you should take the determinant of the matrix sigma lambda I plus I minus j. The sigma lambda I can be sigma sigma L sigma T is the character of symmetric power of V, which is easy to figure out. Okay, so in this case, although there are plenty of atypical representations which occur, I still can find the formula, and this is not a formula. And you can actually start studying representation theory of general elements with this question, right? In this very natural way, how wild did it. But of course, here I don't recover all the representations. and in a dramatic way comparing to the usual case. Because in the so the point is that I also to get all representations I have to add the dual space this time. So in the usual case, this situation can be recovered because you know you have a determinant, the top degree, which allows you almost identify up to twist by one dimensional representation, allows you to reduce the question of all rational representations to the question of polynomial representations. In supercase, we don't have top degree, and it's not going to work.
So here will be the super trace, right? Because you're looking
super.
At not a super determinant, right?
Super trace doesn't allow you to get all the weights to go like this. It's not enough.
It's not enough super trace.
No.
Even if you add it. But super trace is not in there, right?
No.
No, it's not, but even if you add it, it's not enough.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's exactly what I mean. It's not good. But at the moment, I'm going to do something else. I'm actually going to discuss this duality for GL infinity. So, you see, I do have this additional condition star just because the dimension of my space is bound. But now, I would like to allow your dimension to go to infinity.
Sorry, I don't understand. Is sigma t the character of a symmetric power of B?
Mm-hmm.
U is a module for a symmetric group of GLM.
Yes, and you
so
can easily write
which,
it down.
Sorry, it's a character with respect to which action?
Of
G-
respect function of GLM.
And the determinant is taken, that, so that's a matrix.
Yeah,
What's the range of the values?
It's a number of rows, actually. It's a number of rows. Right? If you have just one symmetric one, so one row of symmetric power, and you have two rows, you have matrix 2 by 2. There is an idea, see, I forgot. I'm sure somebody knows this. Jacobi Trudy, maybe? I don't forgot. I forgot how there is such a formula in the usual. And it just works in supercase. But unfortunately, I forgot the name of this one. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to consider the Lie algebra, GL infinity, and in a parallel war, I'm going to consider the Lie algebra, GL infinity. And so what is this? This is a direct limit of GL and M as M goes to infinity. But actually, the question is how I map GL n to GL n plus 1. But as an abstract algebra case, it really doesn't matter. But say I embed GL n and GL n plus 1 as, say, the chord. Okay? So, but you can think about it a completely different way, just the set of matrices Aij such that Ij belongs to Z or to M, really doesn't matter for me. Okay? And such that only finite remaining for finite remaining M. So it also has a representation in rows. So I look at representation here. And exactly in the same way, I can define the superalgebra. And again, it really doesn't matter whether I can increase by one dimension, but as an abstract It's an easy exercise of direct limit. Whenever you put either travel and travel plus one, or you can do this thing. And in principle, I get different direct limits, but they are all isomorphic. And they are all isomorphic to these finite matrices. Only now, I do have like two infinity-infinity blocks, in particular, GL infinity-infinity, zero is a direct sum of two copies of GL infinity. GL infinity, I will put right. This is my GL infinity, right? And then my GL infinity, yeah. Should be left, right? Yeah, that should be left, right? Okay. And again, I have V. Now V is V0 plus V1. So I have two infinite dimensional space. So V is infinite dimensional space, countable dimensional space with the parity sum.
So to the what is GLP to the N?
Ah, okay. Left and right. I don't know actually, you know, I tried to make notations especially for this lecture. So I thought it's a good way to call them left and right, but maybe I should call them up and down. Anyway, I want to use both of them, you know, only both. It's kind of important.
And what about the odd part?
Ah, the odd part. Okay, the odd part is, it's again type 1, right? So I'm just going to write down what I have here. I put this dual, but when I took dual for GL infinity case, it's a sort of restricted dual. I still use star, but you shouldn't forget it, because a dual to countably dimensional spaces, not countably dimensional, but you can easily just think about representation in rows instead of columns, right? And so I put here thing like this, and here I put thing like.
So the 0 and 1 refer to left and right?
0 and 1 are, yes. So there might be, yes. So V0 is a standard representation of G left. V1 is a standard representation of G infinity right. But you should forget that it's really a representation of change parity. And that's going to play a main role in the whole story. Schur-Weyl duality. And of course I can. So if I take on the left hand side V times P, it is still going to have the same decomposition. Only the star additional condition is going to disappear. Basically I can take all the backgrounds with P boxes. Remember that this is a superstring, okay?
So your V here is the infinite dimensional one? No.
Everything is infinite dimensional.
No? Also that V?
Yes, it's infinite dimensional.
Okay.
I just pulled all this, infinite dimensional. It's very important if it's infinite dimensional.
No.
Because, you know, this V algebra doesn't have finite dimensional representations except of the trivial. So now let us think about it a little bit more sophisticated. What we have here, in both cases, we actually have 10 monoidal categories. Right, because it has tensor product. In both cases. Okay. Then symmetric monoid.
Lambda mu, mu.
Yeah.
They are the same both in the supercase and the classical case.
Absolutely. And you see what is happening really when you have restrictions, there are some restrictions on this condition. This is little Wood Richardson rule, but when you don't have restrictions on lambda and mu, except of the boxes, there is no restrictions. So this is nothing surprising. What is interesting in a way, and this is something really maybe a little bit new, is that I say, okay, this is equivalent category, so I would like to construct a functor. Okay. So what functor I'm going to construct? In principle, no, but I'm going to construct, but it surely should be, right? So I'm just going to construct a functor. A functor is a terribly simple functor. So let us recall again. Okay, so let me write it out here like this. I have G of infinity. And inside it, I have this left G of infinity and right G of infinity. And look what I can do. I can pick up a volume. So, actually, at this moment, maybe I should tell you these categories. I want a name for them. So the category here is called T plus of G infinity. And the category here is going to be called T plus of GL And so what I'm going to do is the following thing. So look, if you just look at the picture of these two gel infinities, it's clear that one of them is a centralizer of another, just an algebra. Okay, it's a real algebra, right? So what I can do, and I'm going to take two functors from T plus gel infinity infinity T. I'm calling them F left and left right. And what I'm going to do here is going to start the water. So in a way they have a holiday pair, and what they're going to do, we're just going to take module here and take invariants with respect to this algebra. Just invariants. So what is FL? And it's easy to see that I end up in desired categories a bit, right? Because I just use the fine, but we look at this V0 plus V1. Not exactly, because I should say, take the inductive to end it objects. So my objects now can have infinite multiplicity, so it is actually. No. Okay. So when I just take gel infinity infinity and restrict it to the real gel infinity, I'm not exactly get a tensor module, but maybe tensor modules with infinite multiplicities. But when I take invariants, and I end up again in the same category. Okay? And since I know this decomposition, it's actually very easy to see that those FL and FR are equivalences of categories. We have a joint. G, L, and L. Okay? But if we look what is going to happen and how and what is happening, so basic idea is the following. If I take ES to the tensor power P, so this is V0, right, plus V1, to the tensor power P. And what I'm doing, I'm just going to pick up, now if I take invariants, I'm just going to pick up V0 to the power P. So if I apply to this FL.
I have a question, I'm curious. So could you do it without going to infinity?
No.
No, you can't.
Absolutely, that's the point. I cannot do it without going to infinity. Mm. Okay, and I'm now...
But you get the functors. The one
you get functors, they are not exact.
Ah.
They are not tensor, because why? Oh no, in this case they are exact because categories are simple,
uh-huh.
But they are not tensor, because you know, there's no reason why tensor product of the wire is going to be one.
Ah, so the infinity is
somehow. The infinity here is very, very important,
okay.
Because otherwise nothing works, yes. So that's why I first concentrate so long for this very simple picture. Okay. Okay, so FL.
Sorry, why are they tensor? Can you explain it again, please?
Huh?
Why aren't they tensor?
Ah. Oh, this is just because. You will see in a moment, okay?
I don't understand. You said F, L, and R as inverses, but did you just say...
No, no. I did not explain what are inverses.
Are you going to?
I can. Yeah. It's actually... I'm going to construct left the joint functor. Maybe I'm not going to explain why it is what, but it's really not hard.
Okay?
Okay? But what I'm explaining is that I'm just going to end up with this thing. Right? And if I do F right...
Mm.
And this is just a simple calculation. Vs tensor P, M into 1 with V1 tensor P. Okay? About inverse functors, the joint, the idea of the joint.
Here you break the notation and assume that V1 is an object.
Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly what is going to play a role in the moment. Right? What I'm trying to say, maybe since you already pushed it out, let us see what I end up. FL, say, of symmetric P of Vs is going to be what? SP of V0. But F right. F right of SP of Vs, guess what it's going to do? It's going to be symmetric power of V1, which is actually from the usual guy. If you forget that G infinity is a super algebra, G infinity is an algebra of change parity, I'm ending up with rounded of Vs, of V1. Okay, if I mean it in the usual case. Okay? About inverse, left adjoint. Okay, there is a standard way what you can do. So you start with, you want to construct, for example, you have representation of GL infinity left. Okay, you extend it to representation of the sum. Right, by assuming that this guy adds three variables. You induce and you get something big, but you can prove that there exists a maximum quotient in the category. So let's take induction.
Minimum quotient.
Maximum quotient. And when you induce, you get outside of your category. Okay? So what you do, you take gel infinity. Infinity. And you basically induce from gel infinity, gel infinity. Okay, so you do induction. And then you're outside of your category. And this is the usual way to construct the joint functor, unless it sometimes doesn't work. But in this case, it works. And so we take maximum quotient in the category. So in this case, in principle, I even don't need to construct these inverse functors because I can prove that my functors are fully faithful and surjective on objects. But I want to construct them. The point is, it is also, so looking at this example, you will probably guess what is going to happen if I'm going to start from T plus GL infinity. Because I say gel infinity right and left, but I don't remember it. They are both gel infinity. And I'm going to first imply gl, and I go to t plus gl infinity infinity. And then I apply I, and I'm going again to t plus of gel infinity. Okay? So if I start with this lambda v here, when I go to s lambda of v sub it, and when I end up to lambda conjugate. Okay. Why conjugate?
V1.
Yes, but yes, I get it. But now I have this point of view.
V is V1 is the same.
Yes, but here I take a point of view. I forget that I'm from Supia. I completely forget from Supia, right? And when I have an out equivalence of one tensor category, tensor out equivalence. And of course, this is very simple trick, but it works in non-semi-simple thing as well. I have a very nice trick. I got an equivalence of categories. And if you look at the Grothendieck degree, we are talking about symmetric functions. And what I do, I take symmetric functions corresponding to characters of symmetric, right? And I move them to elementary symmetric functions, and vice versa. And now I did it factoring. So far, this is the whole moral of the story.
What breaks in 5 minutes?
What?
Which step breaks in 5 minutes?
For example, if lambda is here, what? Some of them go to zero, of course, right? Because they are finite dimensional, and something goes to zero. That's what breaks in finite. It only works in infinite case. That's the main point.
Can you write it down? Sorry.
Yeah, the one in the corner there, the FR of FTD.
Sorry?
I mean, if it's finite dimensional, I think FR of SPD is zero.
If P is big enough, right?
Yeah, it's big, it's big enough.
Dimension of V1 is less than P, I end up with zero, right? Certainly doesn't work. Okay? And so now I would like to explain to you that this thing which I call superduality goes much beyond these simple and semi-simple categories, and it goes in some non-semi-simple cases. Okay? But before I proceed, since this should be completely clear now, or at least almost clear, so if you have any questions, please ask.
I just missed what you said about the finite dimensionality. I mean,
I'm just saying that for finite dimensional case, it doesn't work,
Okay.
And that it kills just both of these functors hit some modules.
Okay.
And did you define exactly what the GLs and the GRs are? I mean, is this the left adjoint part here?
More or less. I mean, I defined it, but I didn't do it.
Is that left adjoint? I mean, is that left adjoint to both of them?
No, one of them. So I have GL and GR as well.
Is it supposed to be induced from GL infinity, infinity, zero, R and L?
So let me explain. So I have GL.
Okay.
Infinity, yeah.
First you inflate, then you induce, and then you take the maximum question.
Right, and then what I do, I pick up the guy here, right, and... But I make it into the representation here, because it comes from a line, so this is a trivial action.
Yeah.
When I do induction, and then of course I'm outside of category. But this is a standard way you can check that you have a maximum induction. Okay? So you have all possible forms, it's not very difficult in this case actually. You quotient by the interception of all kernels from this induced model to T, to tensor powers of T. And this is the standard nonsense that it is a joint. Of course, sometimes
it is. What is it?
The guy which I constructed is going to be from T plus
to L
infinity.
Standard nonsense that it's a joint. We know it's going to be left, both left and right in joint because it's an equivalence. So you will get just an index function, right?
Yes.
But standard nonsense gives you...
answer him. I can't answer him.
It's just
the whole conference.
It's just
canonical
joint answer. And it's induction
left adjoint.
Induction is left adjoint.
Yes.
Okay. So GL and this functor is both GL and GR, depending what M is, correct? But GL,
yeah, you mean left and right.
This induced functor.
Depends on what.
It goes to GL infinity infinity.
This is both GL and GR, the same form.
This is an inverse functor.
No, I mean, the functors gm and gr are given by the same formula, correct?
You inflate from a different module, you start with, you inflate from gr to infinity.
Right. Okay. The answer. I'm fine.
Okay. So I'm going to. It looks like I'm going only to illustrate you this duality on two examples, or maybe three. So my first example, and I just probably formulate what I'm considering. Sort of the category of polynomial representations of GL infinity or GL infinity infinity. So I would like to extend my category, say T, I'm going to consider T GL infinity. So before what I did, I took just V, take its tensor powers, and I take all the composable things. But now I would like to add this view. So I want to consider a symmetric monoidal category generated by V and V star. So here I want to make very important remark. This V star is not an algebraic dual. So although I have dual, this is not the dual which makes my category rigid. It's not a rigid category. It's very important. But still, what I can do, I can take possible tensor powers. So I might be use now notation CPQ, V tensor P, tensor V star, tensor Q.
Okay. What breaks? Which axiom breaks?
I'm going to tell it in a moment. Just wait. So you take this and you take all possible subquotients. Now what breaks? He wants to tell me what breaks. It breaks the following thing. I do have non-degenerate pair, right? I have infinitely finitary rows, finitary columns, I can pair them. So I have GL infinity. Wait, equivalent pair. But I don't have the map back. And I don't have the map back because if I would construct the map back, what I supposed to do? I supposed to take the basis, a pair of dual basis, u I here, with u I here, and I want to write down the sum. But this is infinite sum, and it doesn't live on my category. And so now, even if you work with GL infinity, even if you work with GL infinity, your category is not very simple anymore. Because I don't have V, because I do have an all split sequence, right? So I can put in this. This actually can be identified with subalgebra of trace zero, which is a cell infinity. And this is going to be zero. Okay? So what breaks? Because if I want to have a rigid category, I want to have to have both maps. And now I have only one. Okay? On the other hand, I can play the same game for super, right? Now let us play the same game for super. So let us define T GL infinity infinity in the same way generated by
VS, VS star. So I'm not sure I understand the sequence that you write, because it's clearly a Vessel infinity map from V tensor V star.
Yes.
But then the other map, how you, I mean, do you give it the other map?
There's not another map. I put it, that it doesn't exist.
Oh, that map does not, oh, okay. No, no, okay, so your point is that there is no map from V.
This map
no, the one going this way.
Yeah, there is this map perfectly.
Yes,
okay.
But what is
no map, no map. I explained why.
Explain the arrow which is this.
Ah, this map here.
It's just
pairing.
Okay. It's just
trace.
The pairing.
Trace. Okay,
trace.
I have one trace, right?
So okay. No,
but
look at here.
You can draw infinite column, but only finitely many guys don't.
No,
see
for
here.
Sure. Yes, yes. I just want to make sure. So the usual pairing. Okay.
Yes, it's the usual thing. And when you try to build the usual thing other way, it doesn't work. So it seems like it makes life a little bit harder for GL infinity. But the point is, for GL infinity, infinity, it makes your life easier. Okay? And I'm going to explain that in one different way. So what happens if I work with GL MN? Just GL MN. Say I take GL MN. And I take now, I denote it by Vn, corresponding to Vn star. Okay? So of course I have the same form here. Vn here. And SLmn here. But we know something about SLmn. It has center, right? It has the identity matrix, which is the same. I do have another one here. So let us call this C contraction and this E identity. But in this particular case, what happens if I apply C and then E? What I'm going to end up? In general, what I'm going to end up? Oh, sorry, I should put here V and N. So look what I did. I pick up any guy here, right? So what I'm trying to say that this is going to be zero, okay? So, when I, why? Because this is a trace. This is just a trace. But this is super trace now, right? In general. Right? Okay? So one goes to one and zero, zero. Okay. And then it's super trace.
And so you see can go to E is zero.
Huh?
I mean C can go to E is zero. So you first do E and then.
Then yeah, just zero, thank you. Right, that's my mistake, right? I first do
you first do E and then you C.
Thanks. Okay. And so I end up with zero, right? So it's here, I get zero. So there is no splitting.
Sorry, did you define E of one as identity minus the identity?
Okay, so what is here?
Yeah.
I take one,
yeah.
And it goes to the identity guy here. And then I take the super trace. I should end up in the field, but the super trace is zero in this case. And this basically this super trouble comes from this. Okay?
You mean NN trouble?
Yes, NN trouble, but for different symmetric powers you have such troubles in different things, right? But this trouble disappears when I go to infinity, GL infinity, infinity. So SL, infinity, infinity. Is already simple, it doesn't have center. Because this is finitely matrix, so it doesn't contain identity. So this thing is simple. So my category T TGL infinity infinity in a way has less objects, right? Because it has less morphisms than the category of GL and F. Okay? So maybe time for break, 7 minutes. Okay, I spent a lot of time explaining some simple situation, and I'm going to learn some simple situation. And this category, TGL infinity, some time ago we started to study it with Elizabeth Van Cohen and Roman Kim. Myself. Independently, that was studied by Seven Snowden. And it seems very interesting category by itself. So I'm going to talk a little bit about it. So as I already illustrated, the category is not semi-simple. But it has enough injectives, and actually you can easily construct another composable injective. This is the category tensor. You take V, V star, take additive closure, add all subclosures. Abelian tensor category. I think I defined it, right? Yeah. So this is this category that we're talking about. My category T plus, of course, sitting inside. So what is the claim? It's actually basically the claim is if I take tensor power of V and V star, well here I can apply Young symmetrizer, and here I can apply Young symmetrizer, I take the tensor product, and of course in finite dimensional case I have some splitting, but I don't have when I go to infinity. Okay? So these guys are the composable injective with simple circle. Which I'm going to denote V round the mu. So it is enumerated by its parallel partition. And what I how I describe it. Here I give you a description of V round the mu. So suppose lambda has p boxes and mu has q boxes. Okay? So I take so this guy here lies in TPQ. If I consider the length from 2TP minus 1, Q minus 1, okay, so those are tensor powers, mixed tensor powers with one less contravariant vector and one less covariant vector. And I have certain maps which are clearly done. They are contractions, right? Whenever I have, so those are possible contractions. Yes. So induced by this map, V tensor V star, okay, just super trace in this case, because right now I'm talking about the usual general infinity, but it's just the usual trace. I can take many such traces, okay? And so, so if I take all such contractions, okay, so V round the mu is by definition, it's a theorem, it's the intersection of kernels of all these contractions.
I missed what is TPQ. I'm sorry, it was.
TPQ.
Is the tensor, is the pro, is the, okay, thank you. Because it was erased, thank you.
Just to make it short.
Okay, sure.
So, and the so-called filtration, so let's call this I, no, I stands now for injective. So we have enough injective so-called filtration. Here. Can be calculated. By iterating this procedure, so the second layer of the circle, I have homomorphism with U, to P minus 2, P minus 2, double contractions, I take the terminal double contractions, etc. So the last thing, okay, here I'm going to formulate for people who know, who don't know, I'm not going to use it, but people who know certainly will be happy about this. It's a Kazhdan category, it's a self-dual Kazhdan category.
Is it going to be the super duality which you discovered?
No, that's why I said forget about it. I mean, no.
So it's like there are infinite image objects?
Yeah, yes, you're right. You have to explain, I have infinitely many objects, so it's maybe I should put here. But you can easily. You can easily formalize it. I should put here. Because the Kazhdan category, they usually have finitely many simple objects. But you see here, you have a filtration. As so every piece of the filtration is a Kazhdan category. And then my category is a union of these pieces, right?
So that pieces will be...
Yeah, pieces. Pieces are just... Yeah, you have T to Q and T plus Q. Yes, I'm going to go on some more. Okay, and if I just pick up this subcategory, which is not closed under the tensor product, but it is a Kazhdan category.
Sorry, can you remind me that it's, I forgot to believe, all you go from GL infinity plus and all you remove the plus?
Ah, so for plus, I assume only, I take only V and its tensor power. At T, I take V and V star and the tensor power.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. And so what I'm going to do now, I'm going to say, this is another theorem. Ah, yes, one important consequence which is not obvious in before, that every object in T trail infinity is not a subclosure, but just a submodule. In some direct sum of T U I. So in principle when I constructed this category, I told the tensor you have some models but it's subquotients. I could take some quotients, but in fact they are also quotients. And so now I'm going to play the same game. I already know my functors, so I'm going to do the same of T J O infinity. Infinity. And I'm going to construct two functors, FR and FL, exactly as before. Thank you. Okay. And we are just the same thing. They are taking the words. Okay. So there are two things. But now I have to work a little bit harder. I have to explain certain things about these invariants. So first of all, it is a simple exercise that if I take, it's not maybe so simple exercise, but the main reason here is the following. Suppose I want to calculate TPPU, now of, I would say, of B super. And I want to calculate, again, this is my left, and this is my right. So I'm going to calculate the invariance with respect to right here. And then in the usual case, I have plenty of invariance, because say I take lead tensor and star, and I have invariance here, right? But it's not anymore, right? And so it's only very simple. It is just going to be T PPU of V0. And the same with V1. So this, and to check this, what I do? I remember that invariance is always left exact factor, right? So what I can do, but now I want to show that it's really exact. What I can do, I can take injective resolution, and this resolution exists, and it's actually finite. So I do injective resolution, and I do know what is happening on each injective module, just because I have this simple thing, for example, right? So I don't know what happens on this on each module, and therefore I do know that my functor is really exact. I know how calculated on tensors. And tensors is injective cogeneral. I know that it is injective. It is also tensor. And it is tensor because the trivial module is injective in this category. Because whenever I have M in T, JL infinity, and I apply to, so I do this, say L of M. So I can write down M. I'm trying to figure out why it is going to factor. This is because if I write down M1 as some trivial module or something, plus some submodule in a tensor which doesn't have an invariance, right? And I have M, which is some KM, plus n prime, but then in a tensor, my tensors, except of the 0-degree tensors, don't have invariance. So when I do n times on L, I get mn plus, then you know this is the value. But I can think about M and M prime and M prime as submodules and tensors. And it is left exact factor, so on submodule I still don't have invariance, right? So when I tensor, this is sitting inside some TPQ, sum of TPQs, where P and Q are both positive, not negative, greater than zero. And then in the tensor product, it's also not zero. Okay. So the main point here is that TPQ invariance G, say, L invariant is zero if P plus Q is P. Okay, so it's tensor, exact functor, and basically in the same manner as I already explained, I can construct left adjoint to both. And therefore, I have this equivalent. So probably to explain this proof in one sentence is just to say that whenever you have mixed tensor powers at infinity, they don't have invariants. They have plenty of co-invariants, but no invariants at all. And that's the main thing. Well, so you can play the same game. One can play the same game.
Or
OSP or infinity or all infinity. SP infinity and OSP. So here instead of left and right, what I do have, I have if I call this, so if I call this G tilde, okay? Then G tilde 0 even power is O infinity plus SP infinity. And then I have two functors, as usual, values left and right. And they give me equivalence of categories. Okay? And this equivalence of categories, I can go back like this, for example. Since I have range of functors, I can go from here to here. And the reducible modules here, by the way, reducible guys here are just generated by one partition, right? In this case, I just have to take V because V star is not equal to V. Since now I have the generate form, right? And so V irreducible module, V lambda, module is, let's call it gamma. Gamma of V lambda is going to be V lambda the conjugate partition. So my functor here from O infinity category to SP infinity inverse conjugate partition. And now I'm going to talk about parabolic blocks, which I need. Because in records, but I can play the same trick to prove a certain parabolic categories for GL M plus infinity and GL M infinity are equivalent. So we are going to play the same game to show this statement. And let me just formulate the result.
So what do you mean, sorry, by V star equal V? I'm sorry about this.
Ah, so you see. So I have a form V.
Oh, you have a form, okay.
V.
Oh, so you have a form.
Yes. Either symplectic
okay,
or
thank you.
Orthogonal,
using
but anyway,
this
I have pairs,
yeah, sure.
So I don't need this stuff.
So your categories are symmetric?
No. Of course not.
If you don't need this stuff.
So I do have a map V tensor V to K, but this is infinity, right? So it doesn't speed, I can go back to V.
So just on the right lower board there, so these are actually equivalences? These FL and FR, no lower.
Yeah, they are equivalences. Everywhere they are equivalences.
Sorry?
Yes, equivalences, everywhere. simple thing so far. And it is going to be the simple thing. Only now you have to work. I really realized quite late where this proof works. Because original proof by Chiang and Lam and the Wolf entering the sequence of all reflections. But it seems like you can construct functor directly. So, but let me formulate the result.
Initial proof of what? Of what you are going to do?
Yes, what I'm going to formulate right now. Okay. Well, so we have GL M plus infinity. Which is of course just GL infinity, right? So I'm going to draw the picture here. And so that I'm going to draw two blocks. One of size L and one of size infinity. Okay, so it's going to be, and I can draw parabolic here, and parabolic P is going to be, so P is going to be this maximum parabolic in general infinity, okay? And it's really part L, this finite-dimensional algebra, which I call LL, and which is isomorphic. And then I have another one, which is L inf, and which is isomorphic to L infinity. And then I consider parabolic particle one. So I'm going to, I'm not going to mark that it is parabolic, I just try O to simplify my notations. Or GL M plus infinity. So that's a category, subcategory and category O, but the standard upper triangle value. In the whole category O of modules which are integrable over H. Modules which are okay, and so and such that generated by so the simple guys here will be highest weight modules, so generated by simple modules L lambda, but weight lambdas in general have infinitely many marks, with finitely many non-zero marks. So what does it really mean here, if I look at the weight, okay? So my modular lambda must be integrable over both blocks. So my S lambda should be so here I have integers which are decreasing. And here I have integers which are decreasing, but at some point it must be zero, right? But it must be decreasing integers because my weight should satisfy dominance conditions for this block and this block. Okay? So I can reformulate it in the following way. With this condition, I can reformulate it in the following way. If you think a moment, I can say that this is equivalent thing, that this is a category of modules integrable over L such of modules M such that if I restrict M to L inf, so restriction should lie in the category T plus of L inf. Okay, it's not just integrable, but also because it's not exactly, I'm a little bit cheating here. It's not exactly T plus because I allow infinite multiplicities. It's just adding end options. Okay, so it's integrable. It's not really very good. It's different. Okay? So what I'm saying, and I'm not just integrable ways, but also if I restrict from this part, they are integrals. Okay? And so this is a huge category. You can ask about Verma modules, parabolic Verma modules, multiplicities, etc. So absolutely in the same way, I can do for GL M infinity. Okay? Sometimes it's fine. Or GL M infinity. The same condition, the same parabolic, only this blocks outside are odd now. Okay, so it's the same thing. But to make a difference, I'm going to put a super. Ls is Lf plus Lfs M. So absolutely the same picture, absolutely the same definition. Make sense? Now if I cut it, in one case I get a parabolic piece of a parabolic category one. If I pick up some funny block and try to restrict, I get some parabolic category for GL M and for GL M plus M. So this is a sort of the partial pureness which goes in the opposite ways. So what I'm going to do now? So remember what I did before, so now I'm going to do the same thing. Thank you. So I need to define left and right functors. So I call this guy here. I call GL infinity left. And this guy here I call GL. I'm going to take advantage of this statistic. Remarkable thing is that you don't get out of categories. You really, if you start with this, guy here, for example, and you pick up invariants with respect to the blue infinite block, I'm going to end up here, and this is an exercise. And if I do invariants with respect to a red block, I end up here. So still the same functors, F, L, and F, R. And actually, it's not very difficult to check, but the same procedure of induction will give you functors back. And you can check what's happening with reducible modules. So you have left adjoint and right adjoint. Now, there is no tensor structure anymore, because here I don't know how to make a tensor structure. But it's very easy to check that irreducible goes to irreducible. And the set of parameters is the same in all three cases. Okay? So it's this bijection on irreducible modules, so it is an equivalent support. And this is, of course, not a proof, but it is a sketch of the proof. And what it does with irreducibles, by the way. So are you saying
that these are equivalences?
Oh, again, equivalences.
Again, all equivalences.
Yeah.
Okay. No.
I was really happy when I realized that it's still equivalent. Okay, so just before I end up, I'm going to explain just what happens with these parameters. So how we parameterize simple in O GL L plus infinity. So we basically already discussed it, right? It's last week, but it has only finitely many non-zero marks. So it is mu 1, mu L in Z. And then actually partition, because as I explained before, here all marks should be positive. And just lambda from partition. So mu I and z strictly. Oh no, not strictly. Weakly decreasing. No, weakly decreasing. And then lambda is just a partition. With no restriction. And so I have L mu. Well, mu is not exactly the partition because I can have negative guys, right? And it's actually if, for example, this guy here is negative, then for GLM plus infinity, I don't end up with integrable model, but with some module, right? Well, and then. In GL, L infinity, I have the same set of parameters. So it's LS, mu prime, or maybe just mu prime. So if you believe me that this is an equivalence of category, then this guy should go to some guy there. And my question to you, which you should answer immediately, is what is happening with mu how will nu, lambda, and kappa are related? So what is happening? Any guess?
Truth.
Yes. Give me one guess.
You take the transpose of both.
Huh?
You take the transpose of both.
No, lambda is kappa is lambda transpose. So this is one. This is a combination, of course, whatever it is. GL. FR. So mu actually doesn't change at all. So maybe I should put, yeah, here. And kappa equals lambda transpose. Okay. So this is exactly the equivalence, I think. More or less the same equivalence as the
same. So I'm sorry. L mu lambda sits into OGLM plus infinity infinity or no?
Yeah.
Where O sits there.
Sits
okay,
there.
And the other one sits into
yeah.
Okay.
So it's a super is that it sits on super.
Alright.
Okay. And then this is really if you recall what happened with T plus, you will see what it should be.
So I'm a bit confused because on you know on the left this is a non-super object,
exactly.
Right? And so why does the partition and then this I'm confused. So
uh-huh.
Oh you separate the ones from M. Okay.
So the point is that here I can have any numbers. And actually why I it is not necessary that I should take here GLM and integrable modules.
Mm.
I can actually take another parabolic which is going to be just normal parabolic and M part, but here integral. Now, of course, equivalences work here as well.
Then you mean FR composed with GL, right? They are switched.
All right, again, this is FR composed with GL. Yes. Thank you. Okay, so that was. What is happening, and you actually push it further, you can do something for orthogonal, for symplectic, etc. Okay? And now I have 15 minutes, and let me just talk a little bit about symmetric tensor categories, just a few things, because I really don't have much time.
But before I go, is it possible to draw a condition that it's in T plus?
Huh, that's a very good question. At the moment, I don't know. Because when I prove existence of a joint functor, I use T plus. I'm not sure. So the question is how far I can extend such equivalences? And that's a good question. I don't know really at the moment. So maybe I just will talk about the cross condition. So I'm going to show you two problems which have the same answer and which probably have the same answer by some deep reason which I don't know yet. Okay? So it's a little bit, it's in the same spirit, but it's a little bit different. So I take the category GL infinity, infinity. And of course inside it contains the element. So, general man is inside general infinity. Okay, so I do this. And when I can ask, what is the centralizer? So, what's my general man? This is infinity, infinity. Okay? So, both blocks here are infinite. And here they are fine. Like this. Okay. So my first question, what is the centralizer of this? It is again general infinity, right? So the centralizer of GLMN is again general infinity.
Isomorphic.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? Isomorphic.
Yeah. Yeah. Isomorphic. It's a sort of obvious. And therefore, I can, let's call now the centralizer by K. Let's call K. It's L infinity infinity inside L infinity infinity. And then I have a functor, L T, L infinity infinity. To actually representations of GLML. But the functor is the same. It's just, let's call it now, fine. And this functor is basically the same invariant. My k is still infinity, infinity, and I can play this game. Actually, I can play this game in a supercase as well. But now, what happens with this functor? It is still tensor functor. But it is not exact anymore. And it is principle absolutely clear that if I pick up a reducible module here, here of the middle, you remember this guy depends on two diagrams, and I find point this, in general it is not reducible. I think irreducibles in T, I denoted them by E of the middle, if you look at. This is an irreducible guy in here. Okay? So it's not irreducible anymore. See that example of a cell NN sitting inside, or gel NN sitting inside gel infinity. Okay? And in principle, it's kind of interesting to figure out what is this one. It is still left exact, so I can take right derived. It's kind of interesting question, by the way. It's an open problem. But when I move on, I would like to see what is the condition on V lambda mu, but this is not zero. So you put lambda somehow here. So I have two diagrams now. So the point is, I put diagram lambda in the usual way, and a diagram mu I rotate 180 degrees. And I end up the diagram mu here. So if I put fit in this cross, then it is not zero. Otherwise, it is zero. There is no more than one way to fit it in the cross, but If there is at least one, it is not zero.
Shouldn't it be symmetric with respect to M and N?
Not exactly. Why it should be symmetric? No, because one exterior power somewhere and symmetric power somewhere. So this, however, is the answer to another quite complicated problem. And this is the following problem. Classification.
What do you do? Do you think it or do you reflect it?
Nothing. I think that it. Central symmetry.
That's the issue.
Yes, that's right. Classification of indecomposable components. In mixed terms of power. So now my V is again finite dimensional. So this problem was solved independently by Brundan and Stroke. And this. And it is related to this green categories, which I didn't have time to talk. Shell what's going to happen here. So first of all, I have to figure out what is the algebra of endomorphisms over each element, right? And so there is the notion of so-called Wolf-Brauer algebra. So now we put T equals M minus. And there is a notion of what for our algebra, which depends on parameter t. Can I ask how many of you know this one? Could you raise a hand if you know who is the Wolf Brauer algebra?
I couldn't hear.
Wolf Brauer algebra, who knows? Should I explain it?
Yes.
I should explain it. It's not very difficult. But first I write down the statement. And I have a homomorphism, subject of the Wolf-Brauer algebra of T, where T is this, to endomorphisms over G element of V tensor P, V star. So I forgot that my Wolf-Brauer algebra must also have parameters P and Q here. And in principle, this parameter is continuous. So what is this of? And by the way, the fact that this is subjective, it's a rather recent fact, proved by Brundan and Stroke. But it's not so easy. So what is the Borel-Weil-Bott? So basically the idea, how you can construct an endomorphism from here to itself. So of course you have the symmetric group action here, the symmetric group action here, and you have also contractions, but you can apply contraction. But then you have the matter, you have identity. And so you think in an algebra generated by these things, and those are diagrams. So each copy of P, so I'm explaining V, V, 1 of T. So I have two types of vertices. Okay? And I do pairing. vertical and horizontal. Vertical parent is the same color parent. So I need to have perfect parent. Everybody should be male. Okay. So those are normal marriages. Okay, I shouldn't have talked about it, but yeah. And those are strange marriages, okay? So this is basically permutation, okay? Let's see. So for example, I can do something like this. Okay. So in a nutshell, what it is, this thing, you actually, if you work with the Deligne category, you need diagrams. I don't have time here. So this is first you do contraction, so from T11 to K. But first I do trace, and then I do E. Right, like this. And then, say, this thing. It's just the action of the transposition, right? So,
E,
which is a switch.
Just identity matrix and return the list of E.
Yeah, sure.
But they should be couples, right?
So, look, those are these guys. And couples are these guys.
But, for example, the guy in top right.
Should consider them together. So I suppose go V star K.
Yes, it's in the sprint. The guy, top right guy. Top right is married to two people.
Bigamy, right? Bigamy. Yes.
Okay.
Sorry. Yeah. Okay. And so it is pretty clear how I compose this diagram, right? So the only thing I have to join them together, but I can end up with a cycle. And each time, when I end up on the cycle, I must multiply by T. So I concatenate diagrams.
You concatenate vertically.
Vertically, yeah. Each cycle on the middle gives one multiplier of T. Gives coefficient T. Okay? So what about this Borel algebra? It is semi-simple if T is not integer. But if T is integer, it is not semi-simple. And here we are exactly this. So T is in Z, and it's not semi simple. So it's not completely clear how describe the irreducible subquotients, but it's absolutely clear how to describe the composable summons because they are exactly idempotents. So, idempotent. Say, irreducible idempotent. The Borel algebra. Gives me the composable and the composable in this mixed tensor form. And then you can work out who are these idempotents in the Borel algebra. And you can guess, and then again, they are enumerated by two partitions. At least there are idempotents which, so there is certain filtration, and the idempotents are in one-to-one correspondence with bipartition with lambda eight. So I have idempotents which correspond to lambda equals p. Mu equals q, and I have idempotents also with lambda equals p minus 1, mu equals q minus 1, because this Borel algebra has sort of gradient. But those are the main idempotents, because you see, there are some of the decomposable guys which are coming from the previous degrees. And I'm only interested basically in this one. Right? If I have some of the decomposables, minus one, I can pick up a decomposable guy here and still can get another decomposable guy here. Okay? So I'm interested in this lambda nil with such condition. And I'm actually interested because what I do, I apply this idempotent. I should get either zero or in the decomposable component. And the result is that the decomposable E lambda mu of B and the P is done and the P is not zero. Exactly if lambda mu can be embedded in this element. So there are actually some reason behind it, but I think I should stop now. I just want to say one open problem that one can ask all this question for OSP, and we are still absolutely open. Okay, so that's it. Thank you.